church, if you just do with me. Pray for us. God, we come before you, Lord, unworthy. Nothing without you, Lord. So small, yet you call us your own. And we just come here to worship you for that, to glorify you for all the things that you've given us. We're nothing without you, but you enable us. And anything that we do have is from you, Lord. And so we come here to express our innermost love for you and to just worship you for who you are, God. Just continue to pray with me.
Giving it all to God.
Death is beaten, you have rescued me. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. Empty cross, the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Shout it out.
We fall. Brighter than the sun, it steals the night, casts no shadow, there is hope. Oceans rise and mountains fall, he never fails. So take heart, His love lead us through the night. Hold on to hope, take courage again. Death by love, fallen world was overcome. He wears the scar of our freedom in His name. All our fears are swept away. He never failed. So take on to take courage again. Whoa. Whoa. Thank you.
comes from Genesis chapter 29, verses 31 to 35. And it's noteworthy to mention that today is Pastor Steve's last day also at Hana Church. He's been doing such an amazing job in the youth ministry.
We have a special presentation from the VBS, so they're going to do a special, there's a couple of kids that are going to come up and show you a little VBS song, and I think with their teachers and stuff, so we'll invite them up right now.
Alive.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. We're going to invite Pastor Steve up. He will beat the cute factor right now. So they sort of stole his thunder.
That is so not fair, what you guys just did. I am prepared today. I brought my water. And Younger, if you're out there, thanks. I sweat like crazy while I'm up here. And I develop white foam on the sides, I've been told. So last time I did my sermon up here, I came down. My wife just looked at me, and she just went like this. I was like, thanks for your support. I appreciate that. Today is my last day here at Hana Church, and I'll just get this stuff over the way now, out of the way now, so I don't end with this. And I think it's a good thing to end with the Word of God as opposed to end with me. One's more meaningful than the other. But it's been almost 3 years since I've come to Hana Church. So August would have been 3 years. And I think it's time to go. It's time to move on. And last 2.5 years, I think, I don't know if I'd say it's fun, but there's definitely a lot of learning experiences here at the church, and I definitely learned and grew from the experience here. And even in the midst of some difficulties and some trials you go through, there's always great people that you meet. And I think that's what I'm really thankful and grateful for. There's great people at this church, some of whom I'll see at Life EVC, and some of whom I won't see, and you'll be remaining here at Hana Church. And without going into a list of all the people that I would like to thank, I just wanted to just generally say thank you for the way that you cared for myself and my family, and I really appreciate that. Thank you. Thank you very much. So let's pray. Let's pray. I need to pray. Let's get started. Father, we just thank you for this time just to gather us here. And thank you for this opportunity just to speak your words and to be an instrument in your hand, to have people understand who you really are, Lord. Father, just use me. I'm just no one. I'm just someone that's been touched by your grace. And that you just speak, and you say what you need to say, and use me to do it. Use my life to do it, Lord. And we just thank you. We pray for all these things in Christ's name. Amen. All right. So first sermon I ever did at Hana Church was on this passage, Genesis 29, 31 through 35. In the morning, it's always Leah. In the morning, it's still always Leah. And then we'll kind of get to that today. So first sermon on the same passage, last sermon on the same passage. I thought it'd be kind of cool. But as I kind of study this passage and think about it, you know, one thing that really resonated with me was the concept of just disappointments. And disappointments are a part of life, aren't they? And disappointments are just a part of the normal ups and downs of life. We hear disappointment in the way that people speak, in the way that they talk, the questions that people might ask. I remember going to my wife's ultrasounds when our first son was born, or before that. I went to every single one. And I remember seeing the peanut for the first time, and it looked like a peanut. Oh, it was a thing of beauty. And I almost cried. While I was looking at this little peanut that was magnified, you know, a bunch of times. And the first thing I asked the ultrasound person was, so is it a boy or a girl? He's like, you can't tell from that. I was like, what kind of ultrasound person are you? You can't tell from that. So I went to other ultrasounds, like, hey, is it a boy or a girl? It's like, oh, you know, we don't know. And then one day I couldn't go to one, and then I knew that Sarah was going to be at the ultrasound place. And then I came home early, and she came in. She had a big smile on her face. I was like, it's a girl. She said, it's a boy. I was like, yeah. Oops. That's how I felt. And praise the Lord. I didn't want to show anything because, you know, I think there was a little bit of disappointment, but there was a little bit of disappointment. Now that Noah's born, I wouldn't trade him for any girl. Two girls, see you later. But I would not. You know, girls are precious, man. I wouldn't know, but, you know. And then we got pregnant again. And same thing. I was like, man, this time it's a girl. We knew within our heart it was a girl. We did this thing. We get a necklace, and it goes like this. And if it does a certain thing, we know it's a girl. You know, you guys know that? It's crazy when Christians do that. It's pretty pathetic. But we did that, and it totally told us it's a girl. And I was like, I have faith. Not in God, but then stupid necklace thing, I was like, it's a girl. We know it's a girl, it's a girl. She goes, and the ultrasound lady said, it's a boy. And I was like, what does she know? And then Sarah's like, she's Korean. And I was like, yeah, she's probably right. Yeah, so it's another boy. And there's disappointments like that. Or, you know, you feel the disappointment in people's voices when they say things like, man, you know, I really wanted to get that job, but I just couldn't get it. That job wasn't the job that I wanted. Or, man, I don't like living in the place that I live, but if I just lived somewhere else, it'd be so much better. Or, you know, this is not the place in life that I would like to be. And if I was just in this place of life, it'd be so much better. And in the midst of so much disappointment that you hear and in the desires that we express to people, it's almost like we manufacture hope, right? But other times there's disappointments that come from deceit and sin. It's not your fault that certain things happen. Maybe you were sinned against and something or someone else has wronged you, betrayed you, used you, or even left you, you know? But in the midst of disappointment, deceit, and sin, our souls cry out for hope. Because we were built for that. We were built for hope, right? I've spoken about that before. We were built for the eternal. We were built to crave what is eternal. We were built to live in eternity, and hope is a part of that. In many cases, we try to manufacture hope again and start to create it. You know, we'll say things like, man, if I just find the right person to marry, if I just live in that right neighborhood with the best schools, if I could just get that other job, not the job that I have, maybe if I just had children, or even if I were to find the perfect church, my life would be better. Now, these are just echoes of our souls longing for hope. And we spend much of our lives creating this hope and also trying to find the fulfillment of this hope. You know, many times we express that in defining ourselves based on what we do. We meet someone for the first time, and what's the first question that we ask them? What do you do? I'm a doctor. I'm a lawyer. I'm a doctor. I'm a lawyer. I'm a doctor. I'm an engineer. Get out. What are you doing here? And based on what people do, we define who they are. We have an idea of who they are. What do you do for a living? We form opinions based on that. We form opinions about ourselves based on what we do and where we are at in life and where we think that we are going. And even though we're not there yet, yet deep down inside, we know that all of these things are so hopeless, right? And they're tiring. You know, I want to see us to see in our story today of Leah, who was in a very similar situation where she was very hopeless. She felt hopeless in where she was at. She was a person that was the victim of a lot of deceit and sin, but she found hope along the way. So if you could turn with me to Genesis chapter 28, and I want to do some nerd stuff with you, which is to give you the background. Thanks, Mark. I appreciate that. We'll start at verse 28. And Jacob, you got to know something about this guy, Jacob. Jacob, he was, you know, one of two sons. He had an older brother named Esau. And Esau was a guy that Isaac just loved. Right? Esau was a guy, he was a really hairy guy. You know, incidentally, someone came up to me one time, like a youth group kid. He looked at me and he looked at my hair and he said, are you a descendant of Esau? And I said, I am not, you know, I am not. But this guy was a hunter. He was a man's man. But he was raised to believe that he was all that. He was a guy that could do no wrong. Never had to get a cup of porridge by himself. Everyone got it for him. He was served in that way. And Jacob saw that growing up, and Jacob became a liar and a deceiver because of the way that he was treated compared to his own brother. Right? So one day, Jacob does this crazy thing. He gets all this hair from an animal, and he puts it on his arms, and his dad's eyesight isn't so good, Isaac, and he steals the birthright from his brother, who's like a jock, but not so smart, and he traded it for a bowl of soup, porridge, pretty much. And knowing that he had been swindled, the brother threatened to just kill the guy, and Jacob just ran, and he just went. And I just want to pick up kind of that story here. If you could turn with me to chapter 28, and he's at this place called Bethel, which literally means Beit El, which is house of God. Okay, house of God. In verse 12, he said, he had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth, with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. There above it stood the Lord, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, Yahweh. And he said, I am the Lord. I am the Lord Yahweh, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac. I will give you and your descendants the land on which you are lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth, and you will spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and to the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you, and will watch over you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. So that word for God, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D, is the word Yahweh. And in the Old Testament, especially in Genesis, that name Yahweh is basically almost always used in the context of God's salvation. And we're going to see that in our passage today. God's salvation. So God is working. God's promise is that I'm going to give you descendants that are more than the dust of the earth. The same promise that I gave to your relative Abraham, I'm going to do for you. And we need to understand this story that we're going to talk about in the context of God's redemptive story. Now Jacob hears this. He's like, man, I got to have some kids. So what does he do? He goes, sees his uncle, Laban. Now, Jacob is an awesome deceiver. He's pretty good, but Laban is a heck of a lot better, right? So he sees Laban. Laban has two daughters, Leah and Rachel, right? And this is what it says about the two daughters. If you look with me in verse 17 and verse 29. Now, Laban had two daughters, verse 16. The name of the older was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Now, check this out. Leah had weak eyes, but Rachel had a lovely figure and was beautiful. I love that phrase, Rachel was lovely in figure, but Leah had weak eyes. Now, some people think that's about eyesight, right? So they're saying Leah had bad eyesight, but it doesn't say Leah had bad eyesight, but Rachel had better eyesight, right? Leah's eyesight was bad, but Rachel was 20/20, right? So you can go to Leah and go, what is that? It's a sheep. No, it's a lamb, right? But with Rachel, what is that? It's a lamb. It's a lamb. Her eyesight was better. That's not what it says. It says Rachel had weak eyes, but, I'm sorry, Leah had weak eyes, but Rachel was what? Lovely in form. Let me put it in language that you understand. Leah was ugly. Rachel was freaking hot. Okay, that's what it's saying. She was hot. Okay? If Leah was Miss Piggy, right, Rachel is Kate Upton. You don't know who that is, huh? She's freaking hot. Not as hot as my wife. But she is pretty hot, right? So Jacob looks in this, he's like, I gotta have Rachel, the better one, for my wife. So he goes up to Laban. This guy, this fool's great. Verse 19. Laban says, you know, it's better that I give her to you than to some other man. Right? Yeah, I don't want to give Rachel to somebody else. I don't know. I'd rather give him to you. Give her. So Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. Do you like that? Girls eat that stuff up, right? You know, so Jacob served 7 years to get Rachel, but they seemed like only a few days to him because of his love for her. Imagine you're a girl, some guy says that. He's waiting for you for 7 days. He said, you know what? Those 7 years I spent waiting for you, it only felt like days because I loved you. Don't cry. Don't cry. And then verse 21, it's this comedic. Then Jacob said to Laban, give me my wife. My time is complete and I want to make love to her. Crazy. He just straight to the point. Don't say that to your father-in-law, people, you know, when you first meet your wife. So Laban brought together all the people of this place and gave a feast, but when evening came, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and Jacob made love to her. And Laban gave his servant Zilpah to his daughter as his attendant. Like, you get a wife and you get a servant on top of that, right? Now check this out. Oh my gosh. When morning came, there was what? Leah. Some translations say this, but in the morning, behold, it was Leah. I thought it was Kate Upton, but I woke up with Miss Piggy. And in verse 25, you know, you got to listen to this guy's disappointment. When morning came, there was Leah, so Jacob said to Laban, what is this you have done to me? A lot of passages read it like this. What is this you have done to me? That's not what he's saying. He's saying, what the Hades have you done to me? I served you for Rachel, didn't I? Why have you deceived me? Laban, this fool's great. What does he say? Check this out, verse 26. It is not our custom here to give the younger daughter in marriage before the older one. Finish this daughter's bridal week, then we will give you the younger one also in return for another 7 years of work. Man, this guy's awesome. And verse 28, and Jacob did so. He finished the week with Leah, and then Laban gave his daughter Rachel to be his wife, and Laban gave his servant Bilhah to his daughter. Awesome. Rachel as her attendant. And Jacob made love to Rachel also, and his love for Rachel was greater than his love for Leah, and he worked for Laban another 7 years. And you got to think that Leah was going through hell at this time, right? Knowing that for 7 years that her husband would be working hard every single day, not for her, but for her sister that was much prettier than her. Now check this out in verse 31. When the Lord, Yahweh, the God of salvation, saw that Leah was not loved, he enabled her to conceive, but Rachel remained childless. Leah became pregnant and gave birth to a son. She named him Reuben, for she said, "It is because the Lord has seen my misery. Surely my husband will love me now." And what's happening is, as she becomes pregnant and she gives birth to a son, the name that she gives the son is an expression of her hope to get something from her husband, right? There is pain there. "Surely my husband will love me now." She's manufacturing hope. Verse 33, she conceived again, and when she gave birth to a son, I know the feeling, she said, "Because the Lord heard that I am not loved, he gave me this one too." First time, I wasn't seen. Second time, I wasn't heard. This son will make it that I'm heard by my husband. So she named him Simeon. And again, she conceived. And when she gave birth to a son, she said, "Now at last, my husband will become attached to me because I have borne him three sons." So he was named Levi. I want to be seen. I want to be heard. I want to have a connection with my husband. And in verse 35, she conceived again. And when she gave birth to a son, she said, "This time I will praise the Lord, the God of salvation." So she named him Judah. Then she stopped having children. She's going from a place of hopelessness to a place of hope and salvation. And she didn't get it in the way that she thought. It's crazy, because who's the one that enabled her to have sons? It was God, right? It says God loved her. And because knowing that she wasn't loved by anybody, "I'm going to give you sons." And you got to understand, at that time in that culture, having children was huge. Having sons was even better.
Right, word. Sons were even better.
Yeah. Right. I would have done awesome in that culture. Man, you have sons. That's right. Right? That's awesome. But every time she does this, she takes something that God gives to her, and she knows it's a gift from God, because three times she said, "You know, God has done this for me, and I will do this to get something. God has blessed me with this, and he knows what I'm going through, and I will do this to get something from my husband." And three times that she does this, but she doesn't get it. Not until the last time, where she says, "This time I'll do something different. I'm going to praise the Lord." But what perplexed me about this passage was, oh, wait a minute, God is a gift giver, but his gift is not enough. You know, I look at this passage, and I resonate with Leah, not because I'm ugly, but I resonate with her anyway, right? A lot of you guys know some certain things about my background that I'd like to share with you to get you to understand what's going on with Leah. Leah's going through hell, and it's easy to overlook that as you read this part of the story. But Leah resonates with me, right? You know, I had a younger brother. His name is Jack. You know, I'm adopted. My brother is the real son. And I was told that on many occasions. He's the real son. And I was thinking about this. And one of the biggest things that I have is that I'm a very sensitive person. And it's hard for me to say that. I'm very sensitive about my sensitivity. And I remember standing outside with Pastor Sam outside on a Friday night, and we were kind of talking. And he came up to me and said, "You know," and we're talking, he said, "You know, you're sensitive." I was very sensitive about the way that he said that. Sensitive, are you trying to be French? Oui, oui, you know, sensitive. And I was like, what the? And Pat Sam always reminds me of Vanilla Ice, you know? But he's into the whole Asian thing, so it's Vanilla Rice. And what are you gonna do with my last day? Fire me, go ahead. So I'm sitting outside with Vanilla Ice, right? You know, and in my mind, I'm thinking, bop, bop, baby, bop, bop, baby. And he's telling me, "You're sensitive." And then the conversation kept going on. He says, "You know, Steve, you got to embrace your sensitivity." Embrace your sensitivity? I don't want to have this conversation with you. Embrace your sensitivity. Let's go to the Hello Kitty store afterwards, you know? And we'll embrace our sensitivity. It sounds like a Lifetime movie of the week. Next week on Lifetime, Wednesdays, embrace your sensitivity. I don't like this conversation. I hate the fact that I'm sensitive. I hate it with a passion. I'd rather be arrogant than sensitive. I've prayed for arrogance. I'd rather be arrogant. I know so many arrogant people that are a lot happier than I am. I'm sensitive. Can I just get some arrogance? Of course, God says no, because what kind of God would say, yeah, I'll give you some arrogance, right? He doesn't say that. But here's why, and people don't always understand that, right? Now, as growing up, I understand when Leah says, I just want to be seen, and I just want to be heard, and I want to be attached, because while we were growing up at my church, there was a rumor going around the church that I was adopted. And the thing was, they were right. They just didn't know it. Thanks, younger. No? And they did not know that. Because we were treated so much different. Now, I'm not the real son, and it was always a very confusing thing for me because am I having issues with my parents because it's just normal for people to have issues with their parents, whether they're real sons or not? I don't know. Or is this because I am not the real son? It's very confusing to me, right? And we were treated so differently. And people confirmed it. And I went to a deacon. A real deacon, not the other deacons, but the real deacon, the real biblical deacon that I really trusted. She said, and I've been hearing this rumor that I'm adopted. You know, why are they saying this? She said, because they see how much you're treated differently than your brother. So one day I went to my mom and we had this conversation. I was like, why do you treat me so differently than Jack? Right? Why is that? You guys said, Jack, he is the model Korean kid. You look up Korean kid in the dictionary, he's there, right? He had a 4.8 GPA in high school, right? Out of a 1600, back then SAT was 1600. I don't know if you knew that, but it was. He got like a 1450 on the first try or something like that, which I think is pretty good. I didn't get anywhere near that. I put my name on there and I got something. But he got that. He went to Stanford because my parents had predestined him to go there, and he did. He graduated and went to UC San Diego Med School where he got the top surgeon award. Went to a top 10 residency school, I don't even know what the heck that is, in St. Louis, and his salary is, Sarah, mine, and my church salary all together isn't even half of what he makes. That's depressing. So he's the model son. So I asked him, why are we treated so differently? He said this, he's the hope of the family, and you're not. You are going to do nothing with your life. Why would I treat you the same? I was like, okay. But that's not enough. And then she said this, okay, two reasons. Number one, you're not a woman. Okay, I'm screwed there. And secondly, you did not come from my body. I'm screwed there too. And I was like, what is it? Why does that matter so much? She's like, you're not a woman. I was like, I got that from number one. And that you didn't come from me, and there's a connection between a mother and a child that you don't understand. And she said, that's why I could never treat you the same. So where do you go from there? Where do you go from there? Can you just see me as a person? Can you just hear me as a person? Can you just see that I want to be attached to somebody or something? Right? So as I read this, as a Leah, I feel you, sister. I really do. And then one day, you know, I had to work at my parents' liquor store. I hate liquor stores. To this day, I don't go into them. Okay, I went to the one down here. But I hate it. I hate it with the passion. Because I had to work. On a Friday night, my brother and I would go both into our cars. He's going out with his friends. I had to go to the liquor store. I hated it. At the liquor store, I got held up twice. I don't know about you. I don't like guns pointed at me. I like pointing guns at other people. Right? I don't like guns pointed at me. I got held up twice. One time, it was during Father's Day in the morning. I had to work in the morning before I went to church. And I got held up in the morning. And then I went to the sermon that day and said, listen to your parents and obey them. It's not what I want to hear that day, right? So some guy came in, you know, put a Saturday night special. It had to be about an $80 gun, cheapy gun pointed at me in the morning. You know, gave him the money, all that kind of stuff, right? Not a good Sunday. And then it happened again while I was working. And a guy came in, there was a kid, and he took out a Glock 19 9mm, which is a really nice gun, by the way, compact 9mm, and he said, you know, you started cursing at me. And there were people in the store while I was getting held up. They all ran out. And he's just sat there and watching me. I'm just like, they're just sitting there watching. No one's calling for help. No one's doing anything. They're just watching me.
And the guy just pointed a gun at me, and another guy came behind me, and he started taking all the money out. And then the guy looked at me, and he said, you know, he held it like this. I was like, that's not very accurate when you hold it like that. If you hold it like this, it increases. Not very, and he said, get on your knees and turn around and put your hands up. I couldn't do it. I was like, if you're going to shoot me, I'm going to get on my knees. You shoot me in my face. Okay? Make sure you get the left side, because I like the right side. Get the left side, and he just left. And after that, I called my dad. I just got held up. And he said, okay. And I was like, I want to go home. He said, why? You know, logic dictates that when something happens like this, I don't want to be at the place where a person... So I was really upset. So I went to my friend's house, all that kind of stuff. I went home, and I slept in the living room that night because it was so hot in my little closet that I lived in. I lived in a little closet. They made a room out of a little closet. When I watched Harry Potter, I was like, man, I feel you. And I was sleeping in the living room, and I heard something. And I heard a voice saying, get up so we can talk about your schedule. I'm like, what are you talking about? We need to talk about your schedule. When you're going to work at the store. I was like, it's 2 in the morning. I don't care. I want to talk about it now. I said, why are we talking about this now? And I said, Mom, I just got held up today. Why are you so angry with me that I got held up? Because she said this. She said, because you gave them the money. And at that point, my heart just closed off to my parents. You don't give a damn about me. Very painful, right? So when I see the story of Leah, I was like, man, this is a painful thing that she's going through. She just wants the basic needs that any human wants, to be seen, to be heard. And she's given things to kind of people to kind of help her with this. But I think there's a lesson here. You can't separate what God does and what God gives from who he is. Can't do it. See, God is a God that this is who I am, this is what I do. And what I do and who I am is consistent. So I think Leah missed that at first, right? You know, I'm going to give you a son, Leah. I'm going to give you another son. I'm going to give you another son. Oh, man, with these sons, a blessing to God, I will get what I want from my husband. See, you can't take away the gift of God from the gift giver, or you'll misunderstand what God is doing, right? Because what God is doing, he's a God of salvation. He has a plan of salvation. He has a plan of redemption, and she needed to understand that in light of that. But don't we do that all the time? Don't we kind of take away the gift of God, but we forget God in the midst of that gift, right? Let me give you an example of that. Sex. Sex is cool, yeah? There's more than me. I think there's other people doing it too, okay? All right? It's a pretty good gift, right? It's a gift that comes from God. Did you know that? You know, when you get into the situation where you're one with, when you're one with your wife, that oneness, did you know that it's based on the Trinity? That God is one with the Father, Son, Holy. There's a oneness there, and there's a oneness in sex. Did you know that? It comes straight from who God is, right? Man, there's a beauty to that, that there's differences in people, and they come together, male and female, differences, different genders, different person, to come together as one, just like how the Trinity is. Isn't that crazy? It's a gift that comes from who God is. He gives it to us. Now, what happens when we forget the gift giver, and we just like the gift? Then we just become one with everybody, you know? I'll become one with you, I'll become one with you, I'll become one with you, I'll become one with you. And then you miss out on the intimate, this coming together that came from God. God never meant for you to be one with everybody, right? Do you see that? Now, I'm not condemning anybody if you do. If you're married, why would I condemn you? Go for it, you know? Do your thing. And if you're not married, I'm not condemning you. There's no condemnation for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. I'm not doing that. But I just want you to understand that sometimes if we take the gift away from the gift giver, it gets us into trouble. Because our generation has done that. They asked a well-known pastor in Manhattan, what is the problem with today's generation in terms of their spirituality? And immediately he said, they keep sleeping with each other. And the guy said, of all the things that are wrong in the church, you're going to say that that's the biggest thing? He said this, because they've grown up knowing that you shouldn't do this before you get married, right? But somehow they talked themselves out of that. And if you can talk yourselves out of a gift that comes from God, and you separate God from the gift, and you do that, you're going to start doing that to everything else in theology too. Do you see that? So it becomes a very perilous slide where you start sliding down, and it becomes something very difficult. Right? You can't separate the gift from the gift giver. You can't separate from what God gives you and who God is. They're one in one. Because I think what's happening here with Leah, and also what happened to me, is this. These children and Jacob became kind of an idol to Leah. It's idolatry, right? And idolatry is anything that gives you significance away from God. Anything or anyone that gives you meaning apart from God. And for Leah, it was her children, right? It was Jacob. And even though she acknowledges it, man, this came from you, Lord. I'm just going to get it to get something that I want, but it became sort of an idol for her, right? Because she was manufacturing hope. Another thing that we kind of learned from this, and I was thinking about this, is this. We can't get to salvation unless we deal with idolatry in our lives. We can't see God for who he really is if we don't get rid of these other gods that we've created first, right? So in my situation, what happens? God calls me into ministry. Oh, man. Pastoral ministry. Now I got it. Man, God knew that, man. I just wasn't loved at home. And, you know, I keep getting guns pointed at me, you know. I might get lead poisoning at some point, you know. Bullets, lead. Lead poisoning at some point. And God said, be a pastor. Yes. Pastoring is my salvation. It's a high-paying job. I mean, there's travel involved. And I was going to Anaheim from Tustin every Sunday. And it's the house of God. It's how I found it. Now I have meaning and significance in my life. Because people don't point guns at you at church. Right? Only on the weekends when I'm still at the store. And I still had to work at the store, by the way. Even after that. But you know what I found in church? I found church to be disappointing. Right? Man, it's like people complain about everything. Jajangbap again? The kimchi is not ripe yet. I was like, seriously? One time I got a speaker, I invited a Chinese guy to speak for us, and the parents started complaining, why do you have to invite a Chinese guy? Why can't you get a Korean guy? So next time I was going to get a Vietnamese guy, I was going to get an Indonesian guy. I was like, man. And even at church, and this is what was painful, and something that I realized, it was this. You know, at home I always felt like a thing. I always felt like a commodity to be tossed aside and thrown away. In fact, my parents called me a name, my mom. I learned to curse from my mother in Korean. I learned how to curse in Korean from my mother because I was called a lot of these things. And I was basically called like a dog. I don't know if you know the phrase I'm thinking about in Korean. It starts with K and it goes something else. I don't want to say it. I could. What are you going to do? But you just don't. And when I got married, I talked to Sarah. I knew it was bad all the time. But I said, is it normal for parents to call their kids dogs? You know, is it like a, you know, puppy kind of thing or like that? And she said, no, it's not. I've never heard a human being ever say that in my life. That's because you grew up in, you know, West Torrance. You know, nothing happens over there, you know? But she said, no, parents, I've never heard my mother ever say something like that. Your mom's a pastor's wife. You know, they don't say anything, you know? No, they say stuff, but they don't say bad stuff. Of course they talk. Sarah talks, Hedin talks, and people talk. I mean, that's what I'm saying, but she never said that. I was like, so I was just a dog, you know? I was just a thing. But I found that church was the same way. I was like, man, if I didn't bow, if I didn't say hi, if I didn't do this, if I didn't do that, it was get out. I was like, I'm confused. This is pastoral ministry. This is church. It's the body of Christ, Jesus. And why is it that in Jesus, people are tossed aside like they're commodities? This just reminded me of what was going on at home. I wasn't called a dog at church, right? but I was just a thing to be tossed aside. And boy, was I angry. I remember going up into the youth room, I was upstairs. I lived at church for a long time because I didn't want to go home. I didn't feel comfortable, so I lived at church. And the pastor found out, and then he kicked me out. I mean, he didn't kick me out of the church, he just kicked me out of living there. And I was like, man, this is horrible. You know, I was like, how can you toss aside people, but you say you care about people? So because I care about people, I'm going to toss aside people. I was like, I don't see the logic in that. And I saw people and pastors who had children and who were barely making it. I knew one who was getting food stamps just to survive. And the way that people were treated was like, you're just a thing. You're just a commodity. And I remember just going upstairs, and I started screaming at God. I was like, you suck. You should have told me pastoral ministry was like this. This was supposed to be my salvation. Now I finally found significance. I do this and I get this stuff at home. Why do I need to get stuff in Jesus, in your house, in your house? What's up with that? I remember getting the Bible and I threw it across the room. And then I ran after it and I picked it up because I was like, what did I just do? What the? How dare you throw an NIV Bible? KJV, yeah, just throw. Don't you dare do that. So I picked it up, and I'm so angry with God. Isn't disappointment enough at home already? Why do I have to find disappointment at church? Why? Because pastoral ministry and church have become my what? An idol. It took me many years to figure that out. Is pastoral ministry a gift of God? Absolutely. Is the church a gift of God? Absolutely. But I had separated the gift from the gift giver, right? And it became an idol. And I couldn't find salvation because I was trying to find hope all the time. I'll work harder at church. I lived at church. Like I said, I lived there. Worked harder, worked harder, worked harder. Right? That's what we do. Because if you don't, you're gone. Get out. But it became an idol. I could not see God. I could not find salvation because I was trying to find it within myself. You know, Leah, it took 3 children for her to finally realize that. For me, I'm on number 20. But then, something happens. I love this. And there's so much goodness within this passage. Again, she conceived, and when she gave birth to a son, she said, wrong verse, verse 35, she conceived again. And when she gave birth to a son, she said, this time I will praise the Lord. So she named him Judah. Then she stopped having children. And I look at that, and I find hope. Why? Because she didn't find it within herself. She didn't find it within her. She didn't find it within her own actions. And I've been trying for so long to find significance and meaning, right? But something kept bothering me about this passage. I was like, wait a minute, Lord. You almost got me, but something bugs me. There's sin in this story. Who's the sinner? Laban's a sinner. That fool's a liar. Jacob's a sinner. Why? Look at the way he treats his wife. But what about Leah? Leah's not a sinner. She just wants to be loved. She just wants to be heard. And Lord, I'm not a sinner. I just want to be loved. I just don't want to be a dog. What's wrong with that? Because finding significance outside of yourself and worshiping idols, it is sin. Right? It took me a long time to get to that point. But I think this is awesome. She finds salvation not within herself. Because she can't do a darn thing about it. She finds it in someone that's outside of herself. You know what she did? What God was doing was leading her from a place of hopelessness to hope and salvation by getting her to slowly die to herself. Right? So disappointments weren't indications of something that was wrong with you. Disappointments were indications that there is something deeper than what you're creating. There was something deeper than the hope that you're creating. And that deeper thing, that person was God. And she got to that point because God had to allow her to go through this stuff. Go ahead and try. Do this and do that. And God still used that, right? God still used those sons to do something. Levi, Moses came out of it. Hey, Moses is cool. Well, kind of messed up towards the end, but he's a cool guy, right? Right? Those are good things. But he was breaking her down to realize, Lord, I can't do it anymore. And I will just praise you. Right? Because isn't that what praise is? Isn't that what worship is? That we die to ourselves, right? And I saw this movie, it was called The Horse Whisperer. Anybody seen The Horse Whisperer? Okay. I saw this movie, it was called The Horse Whisperer. And there were some people, Robert Redford, I hate that guy. Because anybody who looks like that at that age, I hate him. Man, I was like, dang, he's a good looking guy. So there's a story, and The Horse Whisperer, he's like a horse psychologist, right? And he helps horses who have had traumatic events in their life. And this is one horse that got hit by a car and all that kind of stuff. So there's this scene, beautiful scene, where it's just idyllic scene in this just pasture, and there's mountains in the background. And he just kneels down, Robert Redford, I hate that guy. He just kneels down and just looks at this horse, and this horse is just going crazy. It's just high up and down, high up and all that kind of stuff. And I was like, man, he's a horse, I'm a dog, that's cool. And I'm watching, and this horse is just going, and all day Robert Redford is, even though the sun's going down, but his face is still shining. And he just waits and waits, and all of a sudden the horse just kind of calms down, and then he just comes up, and he just goes to the horse and starts doing that thing on the nose. Don't do that to me, okay? But doing that thing on the nose. And I was like, man, I think that's what God does sometimes. Go ahead and do your thing. Try. Hee-haw up and down. Well, horses don't hee-haw. What do? Horsey noises, and they do their thing. And then God just waits, and he waits, and he waits. And once you've tried your thing, I'm just going to go to you. And that's what he does with Leah. I think that's what he's done to me. It's bringing me to an end of myself, right? But there's this really cool quote from this business guy. His name is Jim Collins. I don't know if you've heard of him. Pastor Sam and Pastor Brian love this guy, Jim Collins. And he wrote this book called Good to Great. And in this book, he has a principle called the Stockdale Paradox. Really interesting, he said this. He interviewed a guy named Admiral Stockdale, who was one of the first naval aviators to be shot down during Vietnam. And for 8 years, he was tortured in this place called the Hanoi Hilton. Okay, it's not a Hilton, it's not like that. It's a POW camp, but the POWs called it the Hanoi Hilton. And for 8 years, he was tortured unimaginably, but he survived. So Jim Collins, I gotta talk to this guy. How'd you do this? And he said this. He said, I never lost faith in the end of the story that I was in. I never doubted not only that I would get out, but also that I would prevail in the end and turn the experience into the defining event of my life, which in retrospect, I would not trade. What he's saying is this. I knew that I would get out. I had faith that I would get out. But what he's really saying is this. I couldn't control my circumstances there. But I knew somehow outside of myself, something would get me out of here. I don't know what that is, but I can't control it. So Collins asked him this. Thanks, Younger. So who didn't make it out of Vietnam? He immediately said this. The optimists. The optimists didn't make it out of Vietnam. He said, why? Oh, these guys, man, they would go, we're going to be out by Christmas. And Christmas would come and go, and they wouldn't be out. We're going to be out by Easter. And Easter would come, and they would come and go. And they wouldn't be there. And they would be out. Oh, we're going to get out by Thanksgiving. And Thanksgiving would come and go, and they wouldn't be out. And then Christmas would come again, and they died of a broken heart. He said, those are the people who did not make it. But I was like, wait a minute. If you never lose faith in the end of the story that something will get you out, isn't that optimism too? And I realized there's two different types of optimism. One is, can I control my hope so I can get out? One is, I'm optimistic some other force outside of myself will help me to get out of this situation. And I think that's what applies here. But he also says this. In the business principle, even though you have faith that there is a light at the end of the tunnel, even though you have faith that there's something good that's going to come out of your difficult situation, you need to realize with utter reality the depth of your situation, right? So Leah needs to realize, I cannot get what I want from acting myself. I need to die, and I need to find hope outside of myself, which Collins calls the Stockdale Paradox. I was like, isn't that what it is? Isn't that what salvation is? Isn't that the gospel? That, you know what, I can't do anything to earn salvation. There's nothing on this earth that will satisfy me. There's nothing that I can do in order to get something from God, but that someone else had to do it. That I have to have faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. He lived the life that I could not live, and I trust him for my salvation. I don't trust myself. My actions mean nothing. I trust in him, and that is the faith that I have. but with the utter realization that I cannot do anything in this world for myself. You know, a lot of gospel preaching is pretty negative, isn't it? I've been pretty negative, right? And it's done for a reason. And here's why. Here's another quote. This is from the Embered website. I know I'm reading a lot of quotes and all that kind of stuff, but I have to tell you it's a quote because it's not from me, and I'd be lying, right? And he says, you know, when certain people complain about gospel preaching, why it's so negative, he says this. To these voices, the gospel preacher replies that life is often, perhaps mostly hard, and that as much as we might crave a word of optimism, a little fuel for the part of us that longs to live in blissful ignorance or denial, what we really need is not to have our humanity built up, but rather put to death. So when you go into a sermon, we shouldn't be about just giving you optimistic things to hold on to. Because we live in the utter reality of a life that cannot fulfill us. If we think about it, it's true. My job does not fulfill me. Even pastoral ministry could not fulfill me. Even the body of Christ, the church, couldn't fulfill me. It had to come from something else. And he's saying, at church, we should not have our humanity built up. It needs to be put to death. True hope, hope in God and his unbreakable love for us in Jesus Christ, comes only when we let go of our false hopes. And this happens only in the crucible of real hard life. In this view, church ceases to be a venue for fairy tales and bedtime stories, but rather a haven for sufferers. Church is a place where we come together to hear and tell the truth about our lives, our sin, and to receive grace and mercy. As Martin Luther poignantly once wrote, if the mercy is true, you must therefore bear a true and not an imaginary sin. God does not save those who are only imaginary sinners. What he's saying is this: you come to church with your pain. You come to church with your suffering. You've come to the right place. But I, as a pastor or anybody here in this congregation, can't give you an optimistic word. Why? Because we're in the same boat as you, and it's called the Titanic. And we need a Savior that comes from outside of us. He's saying, go ahead and bring your sin. Give it what you got. Bring it. But God's love and God's mercy and God's grace is bigger than anything that you can bring to the church. And that's what he's saying. And that is the reality, right? Man, it bothers me, and I'm at the risk of being a little arrogant, it bothers me when I keep hearing sermons of all the lists of things that God wants me to do and the list of things that God doesn't want me to do. Why? Because it's hopeless. I can't do the things that God wants me to do. I can't do the things that God doesn't want me to do. The only way I could do it is because I have to trust that somebody else did it. So if that's the case, why do you keep telling me what I need to do? It's hopeless. It's frustrating. And as teachers and pastors sometimes, right, we don't teach people to live for eternity in that way. We don't lead people to eternity. We lead people to futility. Because you can't save yourself. And Christianity is not a list of things that you have to do and do and do. That's what got us into trouble in the first place. See, it's kind of like this, you know, stay with me on this, right? Let's say you have a brain tumor. Wow, so negative. Hey, it's real, right? You have a brain tumor, right? Now, how am I going to convince you that you have a brain tumor? I'm going to give you an MRI. I don't know what that means, okay? But it tells you that you have a brain tumor. So I give you an MRI and I give it to you. Right, MRI. And this is what you're going to do. You're going to say stuff like this. Man, thank you for telling me not what I wanted to hear, what I needed to hear. I hear that in church all the time, you know? Right? MRI. And then what do? Man, you know, life is all right. It's kind of bad news, but I need to hear that. Because MRI shows me that I have brain tumor. Very good. And then I go, do I have a brain tumor? I forgot. Why? Because you have a brain tumor. And then you look at the MRI again, right, every week, and you have a brain tumor. I was like, yeah, I have a brain tumor. Man, thanks for telling me what I needed to hear and what I want, not what I wanted to hear, right? We hear that all the time, right? And then let's say you have that MRI, and I go take the tumor out. Go do it. Heal yourself. Do you see how hopeless that is? Heal yourself. Go do it. Eat chicken and not meat. Okay. You know, is that going to heal? It doesn't heal you, right? But what if somebody says, this is the MRI. You have a brain tumor. I'm going to take it out for you. Right? I'm going to take it out for you. Now there's hope. Why? Because I can't take out a tumor, but someone else can. see Leah, it was like, man, you have a brain tumor. MRI. And I was like, wait a minute, I can't do anything about it. Oh, man. But the God of salvation can. And when she realized that, check this out, again, she said, the last son she named what? Judah. And out of Judah's line, who came? King David, some really high-profile people, and eventually Jesus. So when I was thinking about that, I went back to the first verse. When the Lord, the God of salvation, saw that Leah was not loved, he enabled her to conceive, but Rachel remained childless. And I was like, at first I thought, oh, God gave her these sons so she could feel significant, right? But that wasn't it. Because God is a God who gives gifts based on who he is, and he's a God of salvation. And he told Jacob, man, I'm going to make a bunch of relatives for you. They're going to be more than the dust of the earth. That's my promise to you, and I will fulfill my promise. I was, that's not what God is doing. God is fulfilling the promise through these children, but these children were never meant for Leah to feel anything, you know, to find significance at all. But it was the last son, when she had realized it's not about her and she had come to a death to of herself, that she would go, I praise you, Lord, because you are the God of salvation. I have nothing to do with it. That she eventually became the mother of Jesus, the Messiah. And God's promise is true, right? Aren't we part of the dust of the earth that God is talking about? Absolutely. So this is a story of hope, not because someone could control it, but because God was doing something the whole time, right? That my salvation has nothing to do with me. And I really believe in once saved, always saved. And before, I used to believe it before because I don't want to go to hell, right? But it's once saved, always saved because I have nothing to do with my salvation. It's all contingent upon who God is and what he does. And I was like, that's my salvation. That's my strength. And that's what gets me through. And in the midst of so much sin, in the midst of so much deceit, in the midst of so much jacked up things that happen in this story, in the jacked up things will not stop there. It'll keep going on, that God continues to work to fulfill his promise of salvation. You know, at Bethel in chapter 20, verse 14, God said, your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth. And with the birth of those four sons, the Lord begins to fulfill his promise. In Egypt, the children of God, Israelites, right, will be persecuted, but they will continue to multiply. And this will happen until the fulfillment happens in Jesus Christ. Even there was deceit and deception then, and there was sin there. Judas deceived Jesus and sold his master for 30 pieces of silver and betrayed him with a kiss. The chief priests and the council used false testimony, deceit, and deception to condemn Jesus. Pilate, the representative of the Roman Empire, knew that Jesus was innocent, yet he still handed Jesus over to be crucified in Matthew 27:26. And God used all of these deceptions to fulfill his promise that Jacob's offspring would be numerous like the dust of the earth. Even after Jesus died and he resurrected, he says, thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to what? To all the nations. That was a pretty dramatic moment, too. Jesus sent out his followers to make disciples of what? All the nations. And in the book of Revelation, the last book in the Bible, man, the beauty of these words. And they sang a new song saying, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals because you were slain. And with your blood you purchased for God persons from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign in the earth. You know, nothing stopped the plan of God. Deception and sin and deceit, nothing does. And what God was doing to Leah and what God has been doing with me is that I don't come in and fix your situation. That's not really human. I help you to transcend that situation and understand what my plan of salvation is. And the whole Bible, again, is a story of God's redemption and God's plan. And we are to understand that my life and everything that happens, whether it's good, whether it's bad, whether it's disappointment or success, it all needs to be put in the context of God's salvation and God's plan, because God always fulfills his promises. And my confidence is not in myself,
but it's in God the Father, the God of salvation. Isn't that what church is? Don't you worship God and praise God? And I think, to me, like, you know, I'm going to editorialize just a little bit, but a praise leader and a praise pastor, to me, are the same things. It's a no-brainer for me. Why? Because a good praise leader will lead people to their death during praise, right? That's why you praise God. It's not about me, Lord. It's not about what I do. I just praise you. And that's what pastors do on Sundays, right, when we preach. A good pastor will lead people to their death and help people to realize that your actions will get you nowhere and that the only salvation that you'll ever have is with God. And it's a reminder of that every single Sunday. God is my salvation. God is my salvation. Isn't that what pastors do, right? And that's what we do here every Sunday, to be reminded of the fact that it's not about us and what we do, that we cannot create a hope for ourselves. We can only find it within him. You know, at some point, I wish I can get to that point where I can say, Lord, I just praise you. And that the disappointment that I've had in my life, you know, I hated God for so long for what I felt he did to me. And it's an issue that I have to deal with every single day of my life. And I'm not exaggerating by saying that. Every day, this comes up. You're not anyone. People don't see you. I was at Starbucks one day, and I was in line, and they skipped me and went to the next person. I started tearing up because she didn't see me. And the barista looked at me. I said, this guy's really serious about his coffee. And I was like, why am I tearing up? Because, again, I had not been seen as a person. I was like, that's so pathetic. Why do you have to be so sensitive? Especially when you're more sensitive than your wife. Man, that's pretty messed up. But I live life every single day preaching the gospel to myself. Steve, it's not about what you do. It's not your significance. If I didn't have the parents that I want, then the father, the mother, I will be your father and mother. You might be saying, I don't have the husband that I want. I have the wife. I will be that husband or wife. Some people tell you that you've missed out on those things and you'll never get those again. I think those are people who don't understand God's grace and God's redemption. Because he does provide that for you. And come to him. Go ahead and try. Get tired. But then drop it all and just come to him and you'll find salvation. Right. Let's pray. You know, human life is tough. It's hard. And we experience so much disappointment in the lives that we live. And so many difficulties and so many things that are just hopeless to us. And I just want you to think today, has God been speaking to you this afternoon? Because he's waiting for you to just give up. He's waiting for you to just come to an end of yourself, that you may find salvation in him, that you will find strength and significance and meaning, not in the works of your hands, not the things that you have created, but from the one who has created you. You know, if you need to come to him and say, Lord, I just want to find salvation. I'm so tired, Lord. I'm so weary. I just want to be seen. I just want to be a person. You know, come to him and just make that your prayer today, because he is listening. He is listening, and his promises always come to fulfillment. And he wants to be that promise of fulfillment for you.
Thank you.
truth where logic fails. Understanding that makes sense of your grace. You are there. Hear the sound of all creation roar. We're crying out as one. Taking us now time and again, let the words in your name, there is love that never fails, and the promise that your word will prevail, you are there. Hear the sound of all creation name, your love display. We are alive in the mystery. All for sinners gain the life you gave. We'll sing your praise for eternity.
We just thank you that you are the God who loves us enough to allow us to even suffer, to allow us to come to an end of ourselves, that you would love us even though we blame you for the things that are happening within our lives, that you're using just to get us to you, Lord, that you're using as a way to indicate to us that there's something deeper than this world can offer, but you love us anyway, Father. We thank you that you are the God of salvation, that we don't find salvation within this confines of the world, that we long for something deeper and we feel alive. We feel like the person that we were supposed to be, the one that we were created to be, Father, because you are the one who has created us, Lord. And we thank you for being the God of hope in the midst of hopelessness. We thank you that you always fulfill your promises, Lord, even in the midst of deceit, deception, and sin, because you are the one that we trust in, Father. We thank you and we praise you. We pray for all these things in your Son's precious name. Amen.